May I speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I wish for us to reflect today on some words from the Gospel according to Mark, the 6th chapter, part of the 11th verse. If any place will not welcome you, and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. Shake off the dust that is on your feet. When I was in grade 9, I went through a rather nonchalant, indifferent approach to school. Haven't we all had those moments? No studying, because I can get by with the work. Maybe a few late turn-ins with homework, etc. And I managed, however, to do well academically, A's and B's, maybe a C, in all of my classes, except one. Can you guess what class that was? They did at the earlier service. Yes, I failed religious studies. There on my report card, while the term grade was a B, the actual exam had a huge F for religious studies, with the comments, "Mario has great potential, but he did not apply himself on the exam." What happened to me because of that? Well, thankfully, I'm still alive. But you'll have to wait till the end of the sermon to find out. How do you handle failure? When you fail to meet a deadline, or fail to maintain your composure and express your anger inappropriately, how do you handle failure? When you fail in a relationship or a friendship, or you fail to perform well on your job, or fail to get the job that you were hoping for, or life doesn't turn out exactly how you expected it to, how do you handle failure? We know that some people do not handle failure very well. They may become consumed with their failure and start to attack themselves. They worry excessively and or become extremely depressed and throw a long pity party. Others become irritable or define themselves as failures, or some become paralyzed with fear, afraid to take another risk. Yes, some people, unfortunately, refuse to take responsibility for their failures, and they blame others for their failures. Well, if you didn't do this, then I would not have failed, or I would not have done that. And yet, conversely, there are some people who use failure as a learning opportunity, an inspiration, and a tool to propel them forward. Individuals who make meaning of their failing circumstances. But how do you handle your failure? Our text today forms part of a narrative in which Jesus visits his hometown. But he is rejected by his own people. The people of Nazareth allow their unbelief, their prejudices, and their familiarity with Jesus to hinder him from doing God's work, mighty works among them. Is this not the carpenter's son? Even though they rejected him, even though Jesus failed to communicate and to do wonderful works among them, he did not allow their unbelief to impede his ministry. It did not prevent him from showing love or care or even going to the cross in spite of their disbelief. In the second part of the narrative, Jesus called the disciples to go out and he commissioned them to proclaim the gospel. He warned them, however, that some people will reject them, will reject their message, and will reject the work that they were called to do. So what advice did he give them? Shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. Don't allow their rejection or your failure to be effective in ministering to them to hinder you from continuing on in God's work, from being faithful to your call. We know, dear friends, that shaking the dust off one's feet was a gesture done by Jews returning from Gentile lands or pagan lands. And in shaking the dust off of their feet, it was a gesture of cleansing and contempt. So when the disciples shook the dust off an unreceptive village, they were essentially declaring that village to be pagan, announcing God's judgment on them, and washing their hands of any responsibility for that village. They were able to then move on to more fertile fields. And here's the point. The disciples' responsibility was faithful proclamation, not success. So move on. Their call to be disciples was not about how people responded to them, but how they responded to God. But their response to people and their faithfulness to God and their calling. In other words, our response as Christians should not depend on how people treat us. It should not depend on what others do to us, you know. It is always our response to them. You make me angry. You do this all the time, and therefore I act like this. No. You act like that because that's your choice to act like that. We are to take responsibility for our actions. Nobody can drive us to do anything. They may influence us, but we take the bait. And so what Jesus is saying is that we are to be faithful in all things. Move on. Don't allow people's actions to hinder us from doing the work of God, from being Christian in our lives. And so when your child or your spouse gets under your skin, be faithful as a Christian. When that coworker gets on your nerves, be faithful as a Christian. Be faithful. Be faithful. Shake the dust and move on. Be faithful to God. Yes, that's one message, but there's more to the text. And while Jesus does not intend to provide us with a recipe for failure in this text, I believe that its message is indeed an applicable one in the midst of failure, because it provides us with a warning, a word of advice, and an encouragement when we find ourselves in the midst of failure or rejection. And so first, a warning. We will fail. Sometimes we will fail. Even Jesus, the most perfect human being, failed in proclaiming God's message to some of the people, failed to be effective to them, and failed to get the message across to them because the people were unbelieving. You may say, well, he didn't fail, they just didn't listen. But his mission was to go there and proclaim, and he did not reach them. And so not because we are Christians, everything will fall into place in our lives. You know, some modern theologies promise health, wealth, and success if we would only but follow Jesus Christ. No. Being a Christian doesn't excuse us or make us impervious to the failings of life, doesn't it? No. But Jesus warned the disciples that they too would experience rejection. And so as Christians, some people will reject our message and us. We will fail in our attempts to be effective Christians at times. Sometimes our relationships will fail. Sometimes our children will err and go astray. Sometimes our spouses will reject our efforts to Christianize them. Sometimes our family members will stop coming to church regardless of how hard we try. And sometimes our family members and friends no longer want to hear about this Christian God that they have known about all their lives. Or everything else may seem important to them other than Christ. Yes, sometimes our efforts will not be successful. Sometimes people will not listen. Sometimes when you try to show love and care, others will reject it. As Christians, we will sometimes fail to be effective. Be warned, be advised. We should expect failure at times. And so with that warning, this expectation that there will be failure, the second word is a word of advice. See, failure can lead to better things. Failure is not the end of the world. Failure is not a debilitating disease that ruins us for eternity. No. Failure is not a measure of our worth, but it can be an opportunity for a new start. And so we shouldn't be afraid to fail, because it can be a great opportunity. And I saw the movie Uncle Drew yesterday. And Uncle Drew is with some of the old basketball players and one who is still in the NBA, Kyrie Irving, and It was talking about just doing things for the love of the game. But in that movie, there was a line that struck me by Uncle Drew. He said to his coach, who had a poor experience, who failed as a child in playing basketball and was afraid to try again. And he said, if you never take a shot, you're guaranteed 100% of never missing one. And it stood out as I was contemplating and I was thinking, oh, I could work this in my sermon. But anyway, be that as it may, yes, isn't that true? Sometimes we have to take the risk, and with the risk comes some failing. Sometimes we will miss, but we use it to teach us how to get better. Yes, failures and screw-ups don't necessarily have to be an end in themselves. They can help us build resilience and character. They can give you insights about your work, yourself, about others, enrich your experiences. They can test your emotional intelligence and add to your knowledge and your skills. The buzzword in psychotherapy these days and in science is neuroplasticity. Right? And the logic of neuroplasticity is that we can use new experiences to rewire old patterns and functioning in the brain, that things can become better and we don't have to stay stuck in the past, that we can get better and we can use old experiences to become better individuals. Neuroplasticity, yes, that's a wonderful way of looking at it. The brain is constantly growing. Before, there was this perception that it stops at age 21, and sometimes, I believe you me, it seems like it does stop at 21, but the brain continues to grow, and we continue to gain new experiences. And so sometimes our highest hopes are destroyed so that we can be prepared for better things. God can use our mistakes and turn them into a mission. Yes. As one person said, the failure of the caterpillar is the birth of the butterfly. The passing of the bud is the blossoming of the rose. And we know that countless stories are replete with failures and mistakes and obstacles. You know that guy, Thomas Edison, don't you? Yeah. Failed over 6,000 times before perfecting the first electrical light. Michael Jordan, this great and still the best basketball player the world has ever known, was cut from his high school basketball team and missed over 9,000 shots in his career. Oprah Winfrey was fired as an early anchor and deemed unfit for TV. Well, we see how that turned out. She should be my friend. Father Mario failed his religious studies exam, and he's a priest today. Don't see your failings as a measure of your worth, but an opportunity for a new start. Failure can be an opportunity. Don't stay in the failure. Don't define yourself as a failure. Unfortunately, some people never get past a failed relationship and thus continue to punish the person they are with because of past bruises and failures. While we all want success, it's not guaranteed. And that's why the ability to shake the dust off our feet and move on, the ability to recover from setbacks and move forward is essential. And this starts with embracing and processing and even benefiting from the failure, actually acknowledging that failure can be an opportunity. That yes, God can use our setbacks as a stepping stone to something greater. With God, all things are possible. And so he said to Paul, who was struggling and begged 3 times, remove this from me. He said, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in your weakness. Has God ever taken a mistake or a failure from your past and use it for great things in your life? That's the kind of God we serve. And so take that advice. Failure is an opportunity, or can be at least. Finally, a word of encouragement. Do you see that in this passage? Jesus encourages the disciples to move on. He reminds them that they are resilient, that when they are rejected, that when they fail, they can get right back up and move forward. We are resilient. We can make meaning of our failings, yes, and we can move on. It fits with the context of Mark's gospel. Mark's gospel is the shortest of all the gospels, and things move very quickly in Mark's gospel, one story right after the other, and so it's all compressed in a few chapters. And what Mark is saying to us is that we can move on. We can get back up again. We can bounce back because we are resilient. And that's where the neuroplasticity comes in. It is one of the protective factors in our resiliency. And so in your failure, shake the dust off. Remember that you are resilient. Get back up again. When you feel like you're failing, when failure impacts your life, I encourage you to do several things. One, feel the emotions that come with failure. Don't just brush over them. Experience them before you jump into the next thing. But don't get overly attached to your feelings. Don't sit in sadness forever and ever and ever. Yes, feel them, embrace them, process them, move on. Reflect and learn. Claim appropriate responsibility. In other words, don't blame yourself or others for events outside of your control. And then next, admit and reframe. When we can acknowledge that there is a problem or a misstep or a failure, it frees us up to correct it and to focus our energy on the next steps. And finally, take effective action. Set out specific actions, specific steps that you must take. And if you fail in those steps, regroup and reset. It's not where you start, it's where you finish. It's not how many times you get knocked down, it's how many times you get back up. Failure will happen, but it's not the end. That was the message Mamie Astwood, my ninth grade religious teacher, told me. She was an Episcopalian / Anglican, and so she knew my mother, and so there's no way I could have turned that F into a B on the report card. Either way, right? I mean, we all did that. We tried that. But anyhow, and you know, when I became a priest, she was very present right in that cathedral. And she said to me, Mario, I remember you in ninth grade. And I had been praying for you from day one to get your act together with that religious studies. I said, well, hello, here I am. And she said, to God be the glory. Failure is never the end. It's always an opportunity, Mario, for a new start. And I'm glad to see you took those steps and moved forward in the Lord. Feeling like a failure? Feeling like something's failing in your life, that things aren't working right, that life is a bit awry right now, or things are going off? With God's help and by His grace, we can turn these failures into opportunities to do wonderful work for the Lord. Shake the dust off and move on. Amen.